afternoon and welcome everybody. Thanks for coming. Appreciate it very much.
Did they let anybody else at home to tend to the fire?
When Annette asked me if I would do a program on New Holland, I said, sure. I had prepared some notes in the past and I thought I'd just read for both. So, get started here. It might take a little while.
It's only about half a page on each one.
Seriously, I thought you'd be bored by the time I got to the second page, so we're going to do a little different, and well, let's get some people who are involved with this, and when I asked them, they were especially willing to come and help out. So let me introduce Mark Jagger, who was the first employee at the New Holland plant here in Grand Island. And here is Ray Reeser, who was the first plant engineer at the Grand Island plant. And Ray Crutchell, who was the first production engineering manager here at Grand Island. I'm still giving tours today. Yeah. My employee number was 8404. I started in October of 1965 unloading combine frames off of railroad cars that were being shipped in from the Kleist plant in Belgium. We were staging those in the backyard until we got the center line set up and started through that area. Also receiving parts from New Holland and purchase parts. John Rohr, who was our purchasing manager at the time, whenever we were looking for a part, he would say, "It's on the dock. Go find it." We spent a lot of time looking for parts, not only from those who were from the purchase aspect, but also that came from the New Holland plant. And we could have been a lot more efficient if we would have been able to escape them like we did later on. The Industrial Foundation minutes, I was amazed when I looked at those. Dick Good, as he was retiring, anyway, I have the copy of the minutes that the Industrial Foundation did with conjunction with purchasing and starting up the plant. A couple notes in there. August 1964, Ron Lipp of Portland visited Grand Island, reporting the need for a plant and also if there was a plant, a need for vocational training. And the Industrial Foundation then went on board with Milford and developed a plan with the Industrial Foundation underwriting one half of the cost. On October 9th, 64, three New Holland representatives came here to look at the community and were talking with Mike Losey, who was our first personnel or human resources last night. He said the original site that was offered was out by Swift, but somebody got a hold of one of the people like Frank Paul and said, "You really need to go out by Swift and smell the area before you put in an expensive plant." So they came to there, but that also was part of what Ray Reese will be talking about here as we get going. New Holland asked for financial help to get the utilities to the plant, and so they were in agreement to take it up to the fence line as such. And the thing that amazes me is on April 28, 1965, and Ray will talk more about this, a letter to New Holland with the option on the Huff property was transmitted. And we started unloading combines in October of 65. And in the meantime, Ray went to work and he done all these operational things, and I'll let him talk about that. Ray Reeser. You.
Thank you, Doyle. thank you people for asking representatives to come and tell a little bit about New Holland. I was a plant engineering manager in Grand Island. I had been in the plant engineering department in Pennsylvania for 7 years before that, and then I still was in the maintenance department for several years before that. So, you know, I kind of grew up with the company. I started working for them in 1943. I had a hiatus, a couple of years. Uncle Sam sent me a letter and said, "We need you." I don't know how much they needed me, but I answered the call, and then after I came back from New Holland, or from the Navy, I had a job at New Holland because that was one of their promises. Any representative or any of their employees that was, went into the service, when they come back from the service, they had a job. They didn't have to worry about going out and hunting for something. So that was the early beginnings. And I, as reflecting upon New Holland and how they came about getting to Grand Island, I can remember as early as in the, I would say the mid-50s, there was talk of a Midwestern plant. It would run hot and cold. It would, for a while, it'd get hot. Somebody saying, "Well, we gotta do this. We gotta go west." And then it would cool off, and then it would get warm again. But in 1964, it started to get to be a real possibility. And so a search party was out for looking for properties, and they had many ideas about where they should be. But I would say probably the final four was Manhattan, Kansas, Topeka, Waterloo, Iowa, Peoria, Illinois. Those were the kind of the four, and then Grand Island was in there. So they bantered back and forth where they would go and so on and so forth, and finally they settled on Grand Island. I had the privilege of coming to Grand Island even before we owned the property. And wanted to kind of give you some idea, we were very much impressed because when our airplane landed in Grand Island, all of a sudden here comes a group of people rolling out of red carpet, and what in the world is going on here? This was the accustomed way of being welcomed by the Industrial Foundation. I can remember Bill Marshall of the bank, Commercial National Bank, Pete Hedgecock was the Rimble Hedgecock Realty Group, and I don't know who was president of the foundation at that time, but I can thought, oh man, this is impressive being welcomed by these people. And they treated us royally. But anyhow, when we made up our mind where the property was, I was with the vice president of vice president of New Holland, and the managing plant engineer in New Holland was my boss, and I came out with those two gentlemen to look at the property, and we had settled on with the Hedgecock, the property of Warren Huff. Well, anyhow, we were out to see the look at this property, we looked over it, and so on and so forth, and Mr. Hedgecock said, "Well, we've got to tie this up." So we said, "Well, where's Mr. Huff?" "Well, he's down in the machine shed. He's getting ready to plant corn." "Well, plant corn? We're not looking for planting corn." So we went down and we talked to Mr. Huff, and finally the net result of it was we bought the property, we bought the corn crop. And now that was in early May of 1965. And in June 6th, we made the announcement in Grand Island Independent that the property was bought and we were going to build a manufacturing plant. Two of us came out here early in 19 August, Mr. Esmond Shane and myself. We were the first two people out here from New Holland. When we got here, we had to settle down in property we had bought. We had been out during the months before that and had found property for our homes and so on and so forth. But I guess I'd like to say that where we settled, I was down on West Oklahoma Street. And a couple doors away from me was the president of the Commercial National Bank. I thought, man, what? This is no area for me. I don't want to go down here. But anyhow, that's where we settled. And then when we bought the property in May, we started moving earth the 6th of June. We announced made the announcement in the paper the 5th of June that we had bought the property, what we were going to build, and so on and so forth. That was on Saturday the 5th. Monday the 7th, we had equipment on the property and started moving earth. Poor Lauren Huff was beside himself. Where do I go now? Where do I go? What? He just couldn't. I guess he figured we would buy the property. Yeah, it'll go a couple of years before they make up their mind what they want to do. We had been so confused. But anyhow, we started building within a month after that. We started building. The first thing we built was a chipping building because we were going to use that as a temporary work office, our work area, for refinishing the combines that we were bringing in from Europe. We brought them into Thunder Bay, Canada, at Lake Superior. We loaded them on air rail cars there and then brought them down into Grand Island. I guess, aside from that, I'd say we started as a manufacturing building just almost at the same time. They were kind of concurrent with each other. But then, over the winter and the next spring, we were putting together the manufacturing plant. October the 1st, 1966, we had opening day and dedication of the New Holland plant. Marcia was our first employee. She was hired when we had our temporary office at Chris Davis Building in Grand Island. And we worked there until, I guess it was early September when we moved our office out to the shipping building so we'd be closer to the operation and what was going on. Let me see, where are we going next?
One of the comments I'll just interject was we had the combine frames on the rail cars.
Yeah, oh, Doyle, I'm going to tell you, the first shipment of rail cars that we brought in, I'm not too sure whether it was late July or early August. The only thing I can remember was going out there on the siding north of Stolly Park Road, sloshing through water because we had a season of unseasonable rain. that's where we brought them in. And we started, you know, I think we, I don't know whether it was Diamond Engineering or who it was, we got them with their cranes that lifted combines off the rail cars.
I think a gentleman by the name of Louis Smith, if I remember, had one eye.
Yeah, that's right.
And he was the guy that was running the crane. And the interesting thing is, we were trying to get it to the right height to be able to put tires on it. But you could tell Louis, I need that much, and you got that much, you know? How a guy with one eye could be so good, I don't know.
So then, after we got the plant operating in the late year, October the 6th, when we had the plant dedication in 1966, we had all the representatives of the Sperry Corporation, which was known as then, and Unisys name come in a little later because of the change of, I don't know, the corporate structure and so on and so forth. I didn't try to keep track of that. They kept paying my salary, so I didn't worry about it. And then I can remember, well, you might enjoy this. I can remember the day we had the dedication. Harry Vickers was chairman of the corporation at that time. And Mr. Vickers and Mr. Ressler were kind of in the first group going down the hallway in the office. And I can remember Harry, and there's a background of this, I'll tell you a little later. Harry Vickers got down there at the intersection where the main, where the aisle from the front door came in, and then the other aisle went back and forth through the office. Mr. Vickers come down there, and he looked up that hall aisle, and he turned around, and he looked down that aisle. He turned around, and he looked back toward the front door, and he said to Mr. Wrestler, he says, I don't know who designed this plant, and he says, this is the first one of your plants I've been in where I can walk down the hall without bumping bucks or something. So that, the prelude to that was the fact that Mr. Wrestler called me one day over the constructing the office, and he said, what in the room are you doing? He said, you're wasting a lot of room in that office. He said, putting those hallways in so wide. He said, you've got to change that. And I said, well, Mr. Wrestler, we got one of two choices. Either we let it the way it is, or we tear the walls out. Oh, he then said, I ought to fire you. I said, well, that's your prerogative. He said, all right, let it as it is. So that's why Mr. Ricker said what he did. Oh my, I could go down a road with many anecdotes about what happened there, but that was our early start in Grand Island. New Holland had started an operation in as part of the New Holland Machine Company, with, as we knew it, was what building farm equipment, had started back even in the 1800s, but the baler operation, which was our primary product, didn't get started until 1939. And we had a plain gentleman, a Mennonite brethren sect, was the inventor of this, because he was concerned that there had to be a way that you could bale hay and not have a half a dozen people involved in the operation. So he started with the idea of building baler. He took a stationary baler. He took the knobbers off of an old binder. And that's what he started working with and manipulating that to make the knobbers for tying the twine. I started working for New Holland in 1943, and I had 40-some-odd years with them. I was aiming for 50, but they didn't quite make that. I don't know, today I think I may be one of the elder employees that New Holland had. So. And I had a wonderful time. And I did many things for New Holland, and they did many things for me and my family. Believe me, they were a good company to work for. And I hope they're just as good now, but I don't know whether they are. Okay, I've rambled enough, I'll put it back to you.
Well, before I leave you completely here, and we'll get, Lou will get into it too, but I was wondering if you might just comment a little bit about the machine tools that was transported out of here.
Okay.
Because there were some sizable breaks and...
There was not only the New Holland plant that was involved in the manufacturing. We had a plant in Belleville, Pennsylvania. We had another one in the community, Mountville, which was only about 6 or 7 miles from New Holland. But we had a fire in the Lancaster plant. I don't know exactly what year that was, but we had moved out of the in-town because we were in a building in-town and there was no room for anything. We needed room to work with. So we bought the old Lancaster Fairground and we renovated the old fair building to start building some of the product that was being built in Lancaster. Well, then we decided when we were coming west we would put together that part of the plant and bring all their manufacturing machine tools. That's where we got the machine tools to start up with Grand Island. We moved that whole plant, machine tools and so on and so forth, out here to Grand Island. And that was kind of an interesting scenario because there was concerned about what we're, how we're going to handle this and so on and so forth. And we brought, I would say 99% of the machine tools that we brought out from Lancaster came out on our own trucks. We had our own fleet, truck fleet for delivering the bailers and so on and so forth. So they had loaded them up and it was just like a convoy, a small train coming into the Grand Island plant. And we had people by the name of Sullivan, a moving company out of Omaha. We didn't have the people to handle these machines on and handle them, so we brought them in as mechanical people to set our mover machines into place and shut them down, and then we could start with our operation. So that. I'll wait. Let me ask some questions
for help. How about a hand for Rick? Thank you. Mr. Lou Buckley will talk in regards to the transfer and give us some insight there in terms of the challenges that he faced.
First, I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I was hired before I graduated from high school, back in 1954. And the reason I got hired is because New Holland had established a co-op program for the school called Reminiscing in Polytech, which is near Reading, Pennsylvania. And the deal was you worked a month and then you went to school a month. You worked a month, you went to school a month. Just kept up for 2.5 years. So that was a program that was established by New Holland at the school. And that the principal of the school came to our high school one time and told us about this. And I went home and told my mom, I said, you know, the principal came and talked about the fact that you get a scholarship. And she said, why don't you go? I said, oh, I don't think I want it. She said, well, you better get down here and find out what it's about. So I said, okay. So I went down and signed up. And I remember taking a battery of tests for one whole Saturday. It was one test after another to see whether they could take it or not. Luckily, I was accepted as one of the two students that they send each year to do this. So that's how I got my start with New Holland, and when my training was over, I had an associate's degree in engineering, and actually even an associate's degree in those days was kind of rare. And so I got promoted after that into supervisory positions, and I worked there about 10 years. I was a tool and line supervisor, and then a machine shop supervisor. And then one day this company showed up on the board and said, we're going to go to plant Grand Island, Nebraska. If you're interested, you see, get a hold of your supervisor and sign up and we'll see if they want to interview you or not. So I went home and told my wife, she said, where's Grand Island, Nebraska? I said, I thought that's got a map and look. So we got a map and looked and, oh, it's the middle of Nebraska somewhere. I said, well, he said, well, it won't hurt to find out about it. I said, well, it won't hurt, so I'll sign up. And about a month later, we're flying on a plane coming to Grand Island, Nebraska. I was offered a job at Fresh Air Management because what I was in charge of were the kinds of things that I had been doing prior to that for a large degree. So we came out here in 1965, I guess it was late 65, early 66, right when it was announced we didn't have a plane. Pat Fielding and I came out together. Pat Fielding and his wife Betty, we were in the same plane flying out together. So we had 3 days to decide where we were going to stay. So in 3 days we bought a house from, anybody remember Marion Morrison from Daily Real Estate? Well, he was our realtor. Daily was a realtor. We bought a house in 3 days. We decided we were going to head down to Grand Island, so we came out here. Drove out in 1966 in a 63 Chevy without air conditioning. And five kids. All under eight. And I'll never forget, the interstate wasn't open yet then, and it wasn't finished yet between Lincoln and here. So we had to take Highway 34 from Lincoln to here. And we crossed over the, I like to fish. Some of you know that I like to fish. So we crossed over the Platte, and I said, oh, there's the Platte River. I can go, there's you. Look at that. You know, I saw him, you know, my wife is foot deep in the hole, I'm not too sure. But this was not like the rivers of Pennsylvania, so I learned that in her. Anyhow, so we came out and got situated, and what I was responsible for was transferring the tooling, for one thing, from the Lancaster plant to here. And in those days, we had different departments. We had pressmanship, we had machine shop, we had sub-assembly, we had welding, and all these tools had to go to a specific department so that we could be located and stored, and we could find them when we needed them, the locating system and all that. So we packaged up a lot of tooling and sent it here. And the other thing we had to do then was the Lancaster plant, prior to moving here, had a production order release system called a Ditto system. So you wanted to make a production order to make a part, you ran off what was called a Ditto copy. And you said, okay, I'll put a number on here and I'll send it to the shop and they can make so many parts. But when we started the plant here, we moved up to an IBM system. And that computer was pretty small, it took up the whole room. And you used the key punch cards, and then we were able to generate these production orders by computer. That was really first class at the time. So we had to make a lot of what we call data conversion. We had to change the process data to convert it to the new system, so we were working on that. In the meantime, I'm flying out here pretty often, visiting with Doyle a number of times, trying to hire people for my department, for tool and die, for tool design, and for processing. So I hired people and set up an apprentice training program in tool and die. So the biggest thing was getting people going and get yourself structured and get things all organized. It takes a lot of work to do that. A couple of the engineers that I was lucky enough to have were sitting back there. Donnery Vincent and Monica Peck were sitting back there. They were two of my early engineers who worked in processing and did that. So, and our job basically was to identify how you make a part, what tools you need to make it, what machines were you running on, and the sequence of operations as to how that part's made and where it winds up. And just how you do things, and then provide the tooling that it takes to do that. That was part of what our department did. So we were a support department, and you had to have that because you couldn't make parts without the tools. In those days, the idea was make as much as you possibly can in-house, and subcontractors buy as little as possible outside because we had better quality control in-house, your costs were lower, and you had to control your own destined parts of it. And so we had a big warehouse that we would just stuff full of parts and then hope we'd eat it someday. So today they don't do that. Today they only make parts when the combines are being sold. And there is no warehouse today. So it's a lot different today. But that's the way it was then, and that was the way we worked at things. Talking about being welcome, Brian, I don't know if you remember Jake Rasmaker back from Jake's Bake Shop. The place called Jake Bake Shop, he did put something in the chamber. I'm not sure what it is. Do you remember? Anyhow, when everybody got moved out here, there was like 26 of us. He invited us all to his place for a Sunday picnic. So we all went over there and we had a great time. We really felt like we were pretty important people, although we really, I didn't think we were, but they thought we were. And we really felt welcome. We went over there and we had a good time and some things and things that just really felt like they wanted to see us here. That's just the way we always felt. So I agree with the greatest assessment in that regard. Let's see. Okay. Yeah, Dick Goodman, the chamber president, said, and you remember this? Yeah, Dick Goodman.
Yeah.
And, okay. So, I guess the main product then was the Model 717 forage harvester. The combine came a little bit later, but the main product to be transferred was the forage harvester. And I think the reason why the company was looking at building new buses is because they thought they could build a plant closer to the market than Pennsylvania was. It probably is, but I don't know how much that really worked out. But anyhow, that was the first product, and that was our bread and butter product. That's pretty much it. I retired in 1992 after 39 years of service. So my whole career started and ended with New Holland. And I can thank the company for that. It's a good company. Okay, that's it.
That's it. Now we have the opportunity for 8401.
Yeah. When Joel called me several weeks ago about doing this, I told him, I don't speak in front of a big group. That's not my thing. But he's very persuasive. And so 50 years ago is a long time. And for me to remember back, so much that I don't remember, but I was always proud that I was the first employee hired company in Holland. We started out in the Chris Davis building upstairs, and we had our office up there, and it was Ray and Stan Esmondshade and myself and June Buddy, because Mike Losey, the personnel manager, did not come out until that summer. June Buddy was our hiring person, and he would interview the people and hire them. I would give them aptitude tests, and then I would schedule physicals for them. And so that was a big job in itself. I typed up all of our paperwork in hiring papers, and back then we didn't have computers. You got that big one, but not for and so typed on a typewriter, and it wasn't an electric typewriter. It was a job, but I loved it. The guys were always so good to me, and Stan Esmondshade had put out a note. I got married that too. I started in September with New Holland, and the following June I was getting married. And at that time the plant worked on Saturday. And so I came across a thing that a notice that Stan had put out, and he said and it was a notice because we didn't have email. And it says, it was after our wedding, and he said, we closed up shop on Saturday at noon, and most of us went down to the church to help Mary and Marcia. The knot was tied good and tight, and Marcia and Mike got off for a week's honeymoon to Black Hills. If there appears to be confusion in the office out here, in the next week, you will know what has happened.
Yes.
It was a wonderful place to work, and I stayed at New Holland until the summer of 70 when I quit this stable with was expecting a stable with our kids. So. But it was wonderful, and thank you.
8,400 employees here, and I'd like to ask you to stand, give us your name, and give us your first job. Don't be bashful.
Norm Elsmeyer, 8409, Assembly was my first job.
Very good, thank you. What?
Wayne Hawes, I'm 8406. My first job was picking those combines off the siding and picking up young chicken building.
Very good.
Bob Oxner, 8463. My first job was picking all the screw ups on the combine.
Yes.
Tom Fostermeyer, 8452. I started over in the shipping building, helping them load the combines and reloading the finished ones back on the rail car.
Very good. Who else?
Bob Snyder.
What's your name?
Bob Snyder. Our company, 8432, and I work on the combine line of sending engines. My first job.
Thank you, Bob.
John Meister, my stock number is 4253. I got a late start out ready to start until 1974. I retired from there in 2004. I started out in a machine shop in Crescent here for 90 days. At the end of 90 days, I got into maintenance. I spent the next 29 years, 9 months.
Thank you. Thank you. Any others?
I'm Max Stanislaw, 4029. I started in 73. When I started, Doyle was the assembly manager in the plant, and I started making the front wheel drives for the speed rollers in sub-assemblies.
Neat. Thanks, Max.
Anyway, I started in November of 65, building axles for 717 choppers, also a number of other things for choppers. And the best thing I liked about New Holland was their retirement program and their insurance, and I had a daughter born in 67 when I was there 4 months. We still got the baby shoes, but they remain.
Thank you. Any others? Let's check. How about me?
What's your number?
8404. Started over in the shipping building there when we were receiving parts.
Here's my number.
Receiving parts for the combines that we set up the assembly line. And Gene Groff, with industrial engineering at the time, set up 9 stations. And started them in at the west side and went through down to the south side. Went through Ray Reeser's washing machine and paint booth. Went over to Decal, and then we put them on the rail cars and shipped them off. One of the things that I wanted to do was enumerate the efforts that Dick Good put into making this happen. And Dick, of course, passed away, I think it was in 78. But the industrial foundation members, and I'll just go through and read these facts, but see if you, these ring any bells with you. Bill Marshall, Jr., Pete Hedgecock, Bill Martin, Ray Baxter, Norm McKay, Jake Resnick, Allen, M.H.L., whatever H.M.H. is, George Armstrong, Wilbur Bachman, Jim Belzer, William Henke, William Height, Dick Kinman, Paul Larson, Walt Morrison, Don Mertz, Jim Mosslander, Howard Peterson, Allie Ray, R.E. Speltz, S.N. Walbach, and John Comforter. And when Dick retired and Roger was cleaning out the files, Dick gave me the copies of the minutes that pertain to the decision to bring New Holland to Grand Island. And I have those here with the ones that made the nominations and the ones that made the seconds and the ones that did the voting. So anyway, I thought it was good to call attention to that. What I'd like to do now is, while we have the privilege of having these people with us, is take the traveling microphone here, if we can, and see what questions you might have that we might be able to answer, or put off until a later time.
While we're doing that, Dick's wife, Virginia, is here. She brings brownies to every voice of the panel. Stand up and be recognized.
I see some other New Holland employees here that are after the 8400. Would you just please stand up and be recognized? Questions. Who has the first question? Right here. That's the baby back there. They need to hear your question.
They'll hear me. I have a question for this lady. These gentlemen came from back east. Where did you come from, and how did you happen to be hired?
I graduated from high school up in South Dakota. I went off to Minneapolis to school for a year. I came back. Then I decided I didn't want to go back to school. So I got a job at a hearing aid center here in town. And my bosses left on Monday morning and traveled and came back on Friday. So I had the whole office to maintain during the week. And I think that was what impressed New Holland, that I graduated from business school, I've done that, and I don't know, I was just very lucky.
Where did you apply? How did you find out about the job?
I really don't remember. It must have been in the paper or somewhere, and I don't share this too often, but my close interview came out, and he was the personnel manager, Bethany Holland, and he came out and he interviewed at the Holiday Inn in his room.
Your experience
with my wife.
Well, I'm sorry, but it's who was the plant manager at the time, and that came, went home, and almost about a week later, 2 weeks later, as such, this little sweetheart came over and said, there's a house, Taylor Hay at the time. And she called and she said, there's a gentleman that New Holland wants to talk to you. And so.
Well, I was saying, you would have to apply for.
Well, that was after that. Mike Losey was the human resources person. And one of the things that Mike said, be sure and tell him about your testing program that we did down at the bank. And in between tests, Mike came up and he said, and what do you want to do? And I said, well, I understand you have an airplane and your chance of getting a job with the Grand Island airplane when you get it here. And he had his hands full of papers and went like that. He said, I don't need a pilot, I need an assembly man. So anyway, that's one black foot made of work. Next question, back here.
I just had a little bit to go along with Doyle and you. I worked for a probate company for quite a few years before I went out to Holland, and I got to know Doyle's dad. And I always wanted to tell Doyle this, but now is a good time to tell him. I talked to your dad one time, he told me that Doyle would never go to Mount Kenny.
Next question.
Doyle?
Any others?
Doyle, how many people did we hire the first time around? When the plant first opened, how many did we employ?
I'm going to ask for help, wasn't I?
100.
The first group.
Kind of stopped right there.
That's when we started over in the main manufacturing building with the working veterans at the Church of Event. I remember that I went over to stand because we got finished with the first tough fight on. And I said, well, we only got two left, Stan. I think my job here is pretty well finished up. And he said, why don't you go to a machine shop for me? And I said, I can go home with a drill press, you know, but I don't know anything about machine tools. And he said, well, you got Floyd Gerhardt and you got Lou Frockel. They'll both help you if you just ask them. And I'll always remember Lou and Floyd going around, you were talking about tooling.
Yeah.
Well, this particular part had to have a tool. Well, that happened several times. But anyway, Floyd would say, well, it looks kind of like this. And Lou would say, I think I know where that might be. So round and round and round we went looking for tooling because the economic loss, like Lou said, you built as many as you could justify doing once you got the operation set up. Next question. Any other comments?
Stand up.
I am standing. New Holland was a wonderful plant in those days. I assume it is yet. But it was a family-oriented place to work. They were always very caring about what we, Marsha and I were talking about that. We were all family at that time. And we used to get together and do lots of things together. They had an employees dinner. I can remember that. And we, all the women got really nice gifts, pewter from Pennsylvania and such. They had to stop that later because the plant was so big. We also had family picnics, and the kids loved it. And it was just, it was a big, we went, took over Stolly Park, I think is where we usually went. I mean, it was a plant that
people cared. I mean, whatever. I wanted to bring that out because I'm not sure that all manufacturing plants have that mentality anymore, but they sure did then. And it was, I couldn't resent the fact that in the morning I had to go out and hay the cattle, and at night I had to do it again because he was gone morning before light and home after dark. So. And I was a town girl.
Even though I actually finished my career in 1992 or the end of that, the last 17 years I've been doing tour guiding at the plant, which I really enjoy. So I want to take this opportunity to invite you, if you want, to get a hold of Shorty Simmons and arrange a tour and see how we do things today. And frankly, it's considerably different today than what it was when the payment first built. So if any of you have an interest, I invite you to do that, and maybe I'll be worth it. Your tour guide is not maybe the recommended John or Lonnie or some of the other guys. We invite five of us that are retirees that do tour guiding. And we really like that, and we like that people are coming to do what the plan is like today. So just wanted to make you aware of that.
Go in the front door.
You go in the business center. But you need to call Charlene Simmons and arrange it first so that one of us is available to take you to tour.
I'm just curious, what type of groups do you give tours to?
All kinds of groups. And even if a single person can sometimes come in and take a tour, I've done that. So I've done anywhere from one single person up to 20 or so people in a group. We usually try to keep it at 10 in a group or less, because it's easier to make sure people don't get lost. and it really is how you do, but all sorts of groups, not just, all kinds of, we people give it to 4-H kids. We like the 4-H kids because they are behaved and they listen to you. And I'm seriously, they're disciplined, and that means a lot when you're in a plant, there's a lot of danger. So, to all kinds of groups.
No question.
Yes. Okay. Couple things. Number one, I talked to Michael Osi last night, and I have his New Holland Way of Human Resources appraisal here, which I'll hold out. But I asked him if he had any comments. He said Grand Island was a tremendous place for me to go to start. And you might not know, but Mike went from here to Human Resources at Sperry, went from there to Unisys. From there, went into the National Human Resource Organization, which has 285,000 members in D.C., and was there for several years. Interestingly, we had a group of Grand Islanders that were going back for a conference at the time, and so they said, Dawg, would you give us a little tour about D.C.? Well, we headed out to Vernon, to George Washington place, and we got there too late. But I said, well, Mike Mosley's place is right around the corner here. Let's just drive by. And so we went wheeling around there, and Mike was out front. It was after Halloween, and he had some cake bales out front, straw bales, that he was picking up. And so we reeled into the driveway there and honked at him, and he invited us in for a cup of coffee, and so we had a chance to see a little bit of the operation that he was involved with back in D.C. But anyway, he lost his wife, and he's now married to Marla. Thank you, Marla, who is a retired Boeing human resources person. He's now down in Florida, and on the east side of Florida as such, but he's passed on some positive things for me to them. I appreciate it very much, and he said, send me a couple pictures, will you? So, unless there's anything else, you saw those people who stood up for 84 and other New Hollanders, here's an opportunity to get some questions that you might have particulars about answered. Also over here are some handouts on the left and lower corner, and those I printed out of the innovator's book. As such, as it pertains to the timeline, and I don't know how many New Holland employees might have the innovator book. This is mine, so please don't take it. And also a brochure with some of the other subjects from the newspaper here. Anything else for good of the cause?
Yeah,
Ray, you want to say something?
Yeah, I want to say something. I think I left a little bit of me in Grand Island when I left the area. I served in the city council for 4 years while I was in Grand Island in the 1970s. And one of the last things that I put any effort into is a little generating station down here along the river. I can remember working with the engineering company out of Kansas City, working on getting that done. Just a little prelude to that, when the reclamation area was building the plant, or building the dam up in Dakotas, and getting ready to generate power, I worked to try and get power off of that power line to supply Grand Island and to help our community here. But they told me, when I asked them about whether we could get power from them, no, it's all allotted. And I said, it's allotted? Where is it? Well, we got this and this and this, so there's no more electricity available from that out operation. So that's when we determined that we were going to build a municipal power plant here. We already had one here on Plum Street. And so that I got involved in that very heavily. So I guess I can say I left a little bit of me in Grand Island in Pomos County.
And where are you at now, Ray?
I'm living out in Holdridge.
And why are you in Holdridge?
Well, I needed some place to retire. I retired after I retired from New Holland. Honeydew worked for several years after I retired. I think you all know what honeydew work is. My wife said I had too many honeys. I moved into Holdridge in the late 90s and took up residency there. And my handiwork was wood shavings and dust sawdust. But you mentioned Mike Losey. I don't know whether you know this or not, but I got a story I got to tell you on Mike Losey. Mike had owned a house down here in the south side of Grand Island, and the driveway in his house, he had a driveway in and went around and then back out several feet away. So you had a drive around in there. And he had an island in the center of that. And he wondered, what in the world can I put in there? And somehow or other, Mike was down along the river and he found an old tree trunk of driftwood. And Mike said, hey, you know, I think that would be great. So he moved that up to his house there, and it was out in front. And it was a nice looking piece. Well, anyhow, when Mike moved back to New Holland, we had a new plant, our personnel manager come in, who was from the East Coast. And he came into my office one day and he said, Reeser, what in the world can I do with that piece of driftwood? He said, I don't like that. And so I thought a little bit about it, and I don't know. Give me a little bit to think about this. So I would call him way in, and all maybe 2 or 3 hours later, and I said, don't worry about it, I'll take care of it. Okay, that's all he knew about it. I had my supervisor, plant maintenance supervisor, take that piece of driftwood, and we were shipping parts back to New Holland. So I said to him, I said, the next load of parts that's going back, and I said, I think there's one over there right now getting loaded. I said, make sure there's enough room. And I think, was it Ruben? Well, I can't think of his last name, but anyhow, I said, put that on the truck. I said, and ship that to New Holland. I said, don't worry about it. So I knew the shipping man in New Holland because I worked with him for several years. And I called him and I told him, I said, there will be a piece of driftwood coming in the next shipment and coming to New Holland. I said, when it gets there, I want you to call the plant services man in there in New Holland, and he'll know what to do. So I had called him, and I told him that it would be coming in there, and I said, when it gets there, I said, I want you to take it up, I said, and put it in Mike Losey's office. So all this took place just like clockwork. And Mike, after he had moved back to New Holland, he had taken a couple weeks off because he had vacation coming. So when this got back there, the shipping foreman called plant services. He took it, he put it right smack dab in Mike's desk. Of course, Mike wasn't there for a couple of weeks. And of course, his office was what we called a horseshoe, where all the big managers were. And these managers would come in and kind of look at that and smile and go on about it a bit. And when Mike came in, the morning he came in, oh, he just almost fainted. He kept asking everybody, where'd that come from? How'd that get there? And nobody knew anything. So finally, after I moved back to New Holland in 1979, I worked with Mike quite a bit back there. And he came to me one day and he said, Reeser, do you know anything about a piece of driftwood? I looked at him, I said, Mike, what driftwood? He said, well, that was in my yard in Grand Island. I said, I haven't the faintest idea. Oh, well, this went on several years, but finally Mike figured out. He had kept asking around different people who knew anything about that. Nobody knew anything. But he started putting the dots together. Finally, he came in my office one day back there and he said, doggone, you're hot. I said, Mike, that was too good. I just couldn't pass that. Well, you did it right. Well, that's how I quite loved the last bit of credit.
Reminiscence about New Holland and Grand Island and Mike. Your son's in Holdridge. Huh? Your son is in Holdridge, is he not?
Yeah.
So that's what attracted you to Holdridge.
He brought me down here today. He's a good boy.
Step one over here.
I'd like to know where the driftwood ended up.
What's that?
I'd like to know where the driftwood ended up.
Oh, where'd the driftwood end up?
What do you do? What do you do with it? What did Mike do with it? What did it end up at?
Who, him?
No, the driftwood.
Driftwood.
Florida. Where did it go to Florida with him?
Where did the driftwood that you sent back? Did, what did Mike do with it?
Well, he was working in the personnel department in New Holland, and he was only there a couple of years after he had gone back there. Then he went to the corporate office in New York.
But what happened to the piece of driftwood?
Oh, I don't know. It's a wonder I didn't get it back.
Wonderful. Thanks, Chair. Any other comments? Ken Knott's got one back
I'll
here.
I'll be around a while if anybody wants to.
This is not as good a story as what we just heard. And tell about the phone call that I got at the City Hall about the move of New Holland out of Grand Island.
My ears are not keeping.
What about the move that was going to happen if we were not able to keep the plant in Grand Island? It was going to move back east.
Yes.
Oh.
You were very much involved with that.
Well, I don't know if I want to get into that here. But while you were out, one of the things that Jeanette had asked me to do was to talk about New Holland and also Husker Harvest Days. Well, obviously, as you can see, I don't know what time we want to kick us out of here, but anyway, Ken's been working to get the four people from the original crew for Husker Harvest Days together to do something like this on August the 15th.
The second Sunday of August.
Help me with the date, sweetheart.
But seriously, Doyle, can you hear me all right?
Yeah.
It was a major deal when the phone call came in. We either keep the plant in Grand Island or we move back east. And we ended up putting together 9 different partnerships to keep New Holland here, and we were successful.
What's the date?
The 13th.
13th? August 13th? Okay, any last comments? Thank you very much for coming. I hope you enjoyed this as much as I did.